So I said I would give you a look at the dried painting from my first video, and here it is, and the colours have stayed lovely and bright. I really like this corner here where you've got that bright blue and then the rainbow colours on top. And I did mention in that video, one that I'd done the day before, that I'd not been quite so happy with. But actually, I really like it now that it's dry, and although there's a lot of yellow and white in it, there's a lot of little bright pops of colour in these cells. So I'm really happy with that one too. Hello from London, and welcome to my second creation video. I've been absolutely blown away by the response to the first one, so thank you very much to everyone that has watched it and subscribed and left comments. So when I watched the video back, there were a few things that I wanted to change, so I'm going to have another go. So it's a similar set of colours, but a few changes. I thought I would introduce a couple of iridescent colours. Oh, sorry, I just realised I haven't put my light on. So I've got some Pébéo iridescent gold, which is lovely, and even more lovely, iridescent blue green. Now, I didn't really show you close up the consistency of my paints last time, I don't think, so I'm just going to show you now. And just to mention as well that I do weigh my paints. I know a lot of people talk about doing these things by eyeballing them, just by sight, but until you're experienced, that's quite hard. So I use weighing scales, and there's still an element of eyeballing because you then have to make a judgment, but at least you know, if you start off quite mechanically, that you're not going to be too far off. So I always start off, I've got my pouring medium, which is 60% glue, 40% water. And then I'm mixing that one-to-one with the paint. And then I'm just adding a bit of water, and that's when it gets a little bit more judgmental, but there's only so much you can do about that. And then I do my drip test. So just quickly show you, in fact, I did it twice today. So this was the first one, and there's quite a variation between my white and some of the others. So I did it again, and then I just added a bit more water to this one. So that just helps you know that your consistencies are all the same. I'm thinking about doing something a bit crazy. At least I think it's crazy, because I've never seen anyone do it. And you might be able to work it out from the title of the video. So we're going to see how that goes. One of the things I decided was that I hadn't used enough paint. I know it seemed like a lot of paint, but those cells still got a bit stretched, overstretched. Got a bit misshapen, so, and that is also tied in with the new thing I'm going to do. I'm trying to do this a bit quicker than I did last time. When you watch your videos back, you just realise how slow some of it is. I was also going to talk about why my channel is called Rabbit Hole Acrylics. Now, I took up acrylic pouring in the first lockdown. We were having some building work done at the time, and it was an extension, and there was a big wall above our TV in our new extension, that I thought that I wanted to put some art on. And I remembered seeing this video of something called a dirty pour. So I looked it up and I thought, right, I'm gonna learn how to do that, and I'm gonna make three paintings and then I'm gonna stop. And that's when I went down the rabbit hole. And, you know, over 2 years later, here we still are, me doing, I don't know how many paintings I've made, but something that is still a bit of an obsession and I absolutely love. So hence, having gone down the rabbit hole, I thought that would be a good name for the channel. I'm a bit wary about putting too much of these iridescent colours, because it's been a long time since I used them. I used them a lot in Dutch pours, but it's been a long time since I used any metallics or iridescents in a flip cup. Where am I up to? Should be all right. There's so many things I've learned, and it's really hard. I thought, oh, I'll try and make this a kind of tutorial video, and it's just all completely random, all the things that come into my head. So the thing that just popped into my head then was about the fact that even when you're checking your, you're watching a video and I'm showing you what the consistency is, but how it looks and how it feels and how it runs off the stirrers will vary so much according to the paint, the pouring medium, and probably mainly those two things. I was using, I think it was a Liquitex pouring medium for a while, and it felt completely different when I switched to glue. I felt like I was starting again. Just feels completely different. It reminded me of when I used to play badminton and tennis, switching from tennis to badminton at the end of the summer. It just felt like I'd never played badminton before. The racket feels just so different, and it felt like that. Just like I've never poured in my life. And now I'm so used to using glue that I bet if I went back and used the specialist pouring medium, that I would find that really strange. I'm being very random now in my layering as to when I'm bringing in the white. It's all right. How much do I want to fill these? I've made more paint than I need, I think. And so weird, the iridescent gold feels really thick when I'm pouring it. But when I did the drip test, it was one of the runnier ones. And again, I think, sorry, that was the other thing that it really depends on. The metallics and iridescents, they just behave very differently from the normal paints. So these are all just things you end up having to just get used to, get experience of. We are getting there, I think. Maybe a bit more white. Oh no, so what am I doing? I haven't used cobalt blue for a long time until that last painting. It is such a beautiful colour. I don't know why I haven't used it more. I love ultramarine as well, but apparently it doesn't work well with PVA. I haven't actually tried that out myself. I'll maybe do that one of these days. But I trust the person that told me that. So I'm sure it's right. So that's quite a lot of pink there. Right, I think I'm just going to finish quite shortly. This is a lot of paint. But we're going to need a lot of paint. Let's just jump straight to this. How thick that looks. Right, I think... Yeah, I'm going to stop there. Now the weird thing that I'm going to do, which like I said, I've not ever seen anyone else do, I'm going to, I've poured them, I'm going to do a reverse dip using this. So that's what we're doing. Now I was actually going to put a little bit of white around the edge of this to help it, because when you do reverse dips, it's quite hard to get full coverage. So let me just do that now. Sorry, that's gonna be off canvas. Oh, off camera. Yes, I'm just gonna with my finger. Gosh, this does all seem very thick. I hope this isn't gonna all be a disaster. Okay, here we go. Paint catcher at the ready. And do it from the top of the canvas down. So tap, tap, tap. Again, all of the colours have got one or two drops of my Mont Marte silicone oil. So should get lots of lovely cells. I'm going to do the reverse dip immediately. My theory is that until the cells have started coming up, you can manipulate the paint and you can mess around, do this sort of messing around without ruining the painting. Let's see if my theory is right. So here we go. So many gorgeous colours. Beautiful, beautiful colours. And straight away, well, actually, I'm going to make sure I've got as much coverage as possible. Width-wise, before it goes off. Right, now something, I think that might be the iridescence that are doing that. It's a bit odd. So, here we go. Dip. It's going to create quite a lot of suction between the canvases. I'm going to try and lift it off quite quickly. Whoop. Oh, hasn't covered it all. Do I want to dip again? That's always the risk. I should have. No, that's fine. I'm going to go with that. And it's fine what it's done, I think. No, maybe I will just dip it again. Oh, dilemma, dilemma. No, I'm going to do it again. I'm going to do it again. And quickly off again. Still a bit of a gap, but not as much, and that's fine. I'm happy with that. And yes, I'm sticking with my theory that has not done anything detrimental to this painting. Look at that. In fact, I think it's made it better. You can see I've not put nearly as much white in this time. Too busy talking, but I don't mind that. Now we've obviously got less paint on than I initially flipped because of the dip, the reverse dip. But wowzers! I'm going to cover it completely before I torch. That was one of the things that I decided after the last one. Look at these colours. And we're definitely getting those iridescents coming through. Wow, 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 wow. Now, what I am going to do is be more careful about getting the weight back to the middle of the canvas. Right, I don't think I'm not going to need that anymore. Oh, look at it. Look at it. It's beautiful. So I'm going to try and get, yeah, I'm going to just really try and balance the weight. So it's really centered before I torch. And now let's torch. This is stunning already. Even if I didn't torch, I'd be happy with that. But I'm going to torch. Oh, and one of the other things I decided was I wasn't going to torch around the edge. I was just going to torch around the middle. Now there is still a lot of paint on here, so we're not getting too many cells. A few coming. This is why I love paint pouring. It's just such an adventure. Every time you do it, you don't know what you're gonna get. Sometimes it goes really wrong, and then you think you're never gonna be able to do another decent painting in your life. But when it goes well, it's a fantastic feeling. There's a lot of paint on here. But I'm just really loath to pour any of it off because it's so gorgeous. I'm gonna have to pour something off. Which way are we gonna go? I think I'm gonna go down towards this end. This is probably the least attractive bit. But then we're getting a lot of yellow in the middle there. Oh, indecision. And now that these cells have come through, we have to look after them. We can't let them get overstretched, which is what I did last time. So I'm just going to quickly, yeah, there we are. Bring the weight back to the middle before torching again. Something I didn't do as well last time, I think. Could have done it better. It's really different with the with less white and with the iridescent colours. It's so different. I don't know how much you can see the shine of the gold and the iridescent blue green, but you'll see it. I will remember to bring you down for a close up at the end. You'll see it. Now we should get some more cells because we've tipped quite a bit of paint off. I can see them popping up. Go down too low. Don't want too many caterpillars. Uh, I'm going to torch around the edges now. I just noticed that those are the cells, I've noticed it before, those are the cells that get most stretched. I'm going to leave that for a minute. Just let those new cells develop a bit. And maybe I'll have a quick look at what I want to do with this reverse dip. I think it was a mistake just covering the edges with the white. And because I was trying to do it quickly, you know, I made a mistake really with not covering it all. I think I'm just going to pour a little bit onto the bit that didn't get covered. Obviously you can't see that. See if it looks really obviously different from the rest. I'll bring it back onto bring it under the camera when I finish dealing with this one. So, still not too many cells, and some of them are a bit ragged down here, but the colours are still absolutely stunning. I'm just going to tilt, try and just grow some of these cells in a nice, even way. Yeah, I think there's a danger of overdoing that. I'm just going to leave that. And I'm going to decide later whether I'm going to do my balloon dips. Because it feels like it might make it a bit fussy. But I'll see what the cells are looking like later on. So now I'm going to bring back in the circular canvas. Get rid of this. So that's going out of the way. Carefully. So, canvas number two. So it's two for the price of one on this video. So there is a reasonable amount of paint on here. And you can see I just poured a bit on here just to try and just to cover up the last bit without making it too obvious. I think it's all right. I think we might get away with it. That's finished covering it. I might sort of paint around the edges separately when it's dry or drier. Right, I'm going to torch this. Messy hands again. See loads and loads of cells, but what kind of cells? What are they going to look like? Colours are amazing again. Yeah, I think as often I think happens with reverse dips, and I haven't done many, the edges are the least successful bit. So I think I will just paint over those when it's dry. Again, I just don't want to do too much with it because it's looking really good. I'm just going to see if I can grow the cells a bit. It's not moving very much because, again, when you do a reverse dip, the amount of paint is a lot less, certainly the way I do it, than in a regular flip cut. So that means that it won't move as much. This is the first time I've ever used a circular canvas as well. Very cute. I might have to edit this bit out because it's very slow moving. This is bloom speed for anyone that's tried doing blooms. Yeah. And again, as happened in the last painting, there's a real risk of the early cells getting misshapen. So I'm just going to stop. I'm just going to try and get a few more cells in the middle. And then I think I'm going to call it a day. And I'll decide later whether I'm going to do any balloon dips. So here are the dried results. This is the main painting and lots of very vibrant colours, and also the iridescents have really come out well. The gold and the greeny blue, the two Pébéo paints. So that's great, I'll definitely be using those again. And here's the dip. Again, you can see lots of shimmer there. The edges were a bit messy because there wasn't enough paint on there for it to flow over the edges and cover those. So I've put a coat of gold on it. I'll have to do another one or two coats because it's transparent paint, I think. So, but I think that'll give it a nice finish, make it nice and neat. And yeah, I'm looking forward to having another go, and I hope you will join me on the journey and see what happens.